set the captives free.
Amen.
Your word, turn to Isaiah chapter 61.
I'm sorry.
Isaiah chapter 61. Thank you, Lord. Isaiah 61. I want y'all to go to in the first verse. As we continue on a journey concerning the focus to win, we know last week we talked, my message was, He shall give you double for your trouble. Amen. And we're going to continue from that series, and this is He'll give you double for your trouble, part two of double for your trouble. I believe there was so much that I wanted to give last week, but of course, you know, I would be here all day. We didn't want to be here all day and all night. Amen. So we're going to do a continuation of what we started last week. So in Isaiah 61, if you found Isaiah 61, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. And we're going to read, amen, the first verse, first and second verse, and then we're going to drop down to the seventh verse. Then let us read. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound, to proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord, and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn, to appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, to give unto them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they might be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he might be glorified. And let's go to the verse 7. Drop down to verse 7. For your shame ye shall have double, and for confusion they shall rejoice in their portion. Therefore in their land they shall possess the double. Everlasting joy shall be unto them. Mm-hmm. Everlasting joy shall be unto them. I want to just to kind of give you all encouragement today in terms of God giving you double for your trouble. In this particular part, I want to say to you simply what the scripture says. Everlasting joy is yours for the asking. Everlasting joy is yours for the asking. Let us pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you so much for your word right now. We thank you for all that you're doing and all that you're going to do in the name of Jesus. Oh God, hallelujah. God, thank you, God, that you hide me behind the cross that I will give. Hallelujah, that I speak what you would have me to speak in the name of Jesus. We thank you for those that are here today, those that are not here, those that are on the way. We thank you, God, for those who have not even yet stepped in this house, Lord God, in this temple, in the name of Jesus. But we thank you that you're preparing a word for them in the name of Jesus. We thank you, God, for all that you're doing. We thank you, God, that you move out of the way every distraction, every hindrance in the name of Jesus, every spirit, Lord God, that's not like you, in the name of Jesus. Oh God, we just rest in you. We believe in your word. What you said you would do, God, you will perform. Yes. You will bring it to pass in the name of Jesus. Oh God, we thank you that you're giving us
trouble right now in the mighty name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Regardless of what we're faced with, regardless of what has come our way in the name of Jesus. Oh, we're thanking you right now because it's working together for our good in the name of Jesus. Oh God, hallelujah. It's making us into the men and women you would have us to be, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Oh God, we just thank you. We give you praise. We give you honor. We give you glory in the mighty name of Jesus. Oh God, right now, hallelujah, as I feel this, God, I speak to the north, to the east, Shata, to south, and to the west, north, east, south, and west, right, God. Right now, we say, come forth in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. We say, come forth right now in the name of Jesus. Everything that has held your people bound, God, hallelujah, has got to loose them, Shata, right now, by faith, knowing, God, whatever we shall speak, whatever we shall ask, whatever we shall declare and decree, it shall be done in the mighty name of Jesus. By faith, it is so. And so we thank you and we praise you in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen. Come on, let's give God a hand of praise. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Everlasting joy shall be yours. I want you all, as we take embark upon this passage of scripture and this message today, we're going to catch up. I'm going to try to catch you up to speed to where we were before when we left off last week. As we said in this passage of scripture in Isaiah 61, there are things that the Spirit of the Lord God comes to do. And one of those things we know, if he comes, the Spirit of the Lord comes to set the captives free. But I want you just to kind of look at the scripture again and begin, as we begin to expound upon it, you'll see some things that God wants to bring out. I believe that there are several things that he wants to bring out today, but most of all, he wants you to see that everlasting joy is yours. So regardless of what you're faced with, regardless of what you encounter, don't let go of your joy. Look to your neighbor and say, don't let go.
Don't let go.
Of your joy.
Don't let go.
Your joy is what gives you strength. The joy of the Lord is your strength. How many of y'all know that?
Amen.
Amen. So let me catch you up to speed. So last week we talked about the former desolations. And we know that the former desolation was making reference in verse 6. And we go down, I'm sorry, verse 4 of Isaiah 61. It says, they shall build the what? Old waste. They shall raise up the former desolations. The former desolations mean that which was desolate, empty. What's going to happen? Those things are going to be raised up. Now, it's not just for physical sense, but it's also for you as an individual. God's going to raise you up to do the very things that he has called you out to do. Amen. As we begin to sing that song, this first time it came to my mind, it says, I hear the walls falling. I hear the walls falling. There are walls that are falling in the spirit realm. Amen. And walls that have been up for years. Walls that have been trying to keep you to get to that next level. Amen. And it's through the glory of God. There is glory. The other thing I heard is that there's glory in the what? In the name of Jesus. Other words, that when we begin to call on the name of Jesus, glory follows his name. Amen. As we begin to believe, as we begin to rest in that, there's glory. How many of y'all believe that? Mm-hmm. Somebody say there's glory in his name.
There's glory in his name.
So again, former desolation. He wants to raise up the former desolation. Other things, the second thing we talked about is old waste places. In other words, those things that had laid dormant for many years. Again, whether it's in your life or other people's life, God is going to, in essence, that which was waste, God is going to start to fill those things up again. There's sometimes in our lives that distractions come our way, whether it's sin, whether it's distractions and hindrances, whether it's attacks of the enemy, whether it's afflictions, whatever it may be, God is going, amen, again, the old waste places, he's going to fill those old waste places up again. Somebody say he's going to fill them up again.
He's going to fill them up again.
So what was waste, no longer will it be waste. Now, the other thing we talked about was confusion. Somebody say confusion.
Confusion.
We talked about confusion. 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 There's some things that we talked about in terms of confusion, and that is when the enemy tries to confuse you, when he tries to cause trouble. Have you ever been in instances where everything is going well, and then all of a sudden something comes and the enemy just kind of throw you off and you can't think straight? That's confusion. You're like, okay, what was I doing? What was I supposed to do? Before you know it, the day is gone, the day is far spent. You're like, oh my goodness, I didn't even get done what I was supposed to be doing today. Why? Because that was confusion on the enemy's part. He threw something your way to try to confuse you, to throw you off. Now, here's the thing I want you all to know, and I'm just going to throw this in a nugget. Know that the enemy understands that he cannot stop you. He cannot stop you. But one of the things that he will try to do is hinder your progress. So if he can hinder your progress, make you procrastinate, make you put off, make you stop, he's getting half the battle. So what you got to begin to realize is that even in your time and the things that you do or the assignments that you have, you got to be vigilant about it. You got to be so dogmatic about the things of God that you won't allow anything to hinder the progress of God. And that, again, that even means the time, that means your position, amen, your position in God. Other words, and I said this again, you know, being in position, and y'all know me, I'll tell you this over and over again, and I'll be like, listen, ladies and gentlemen, y'all are in position. If there's set position that you have in the house of God, you got to be in position there ready. When the clock strikes 12. Now, we're not talking about 12. We know 2:30. So when 2:30 or even before that, 2:15, that comes around, we're ready. And that's why I'm so adamant when it comes to prayer, because y'all, we can't do anything without prayer when it comes to prayer. And so begin to think about that when it comes to the house of God. You know, being in position so that when we're in position, we can begin to do the things that God has called us out to do, such as pray. Amen. When we begin to pray beforehand, it sets the atmosphere. And we don't know what has been in the house before we got here.
Amen.
Amen. And so we start singing, we don't even know this is a spiritual battle. And so, but nevertheless, we have to get to the point where we begin to pray and intercede, amen, at the appointed time, amen. Again, the enemy knows he can't stop you, but if he can hinder you, if he can put you behind time, then he knows he can win a certain battle. He won't win the war, but he can win in that battle. And so we have to be very mindful of the things that God has given us to do. So anyway, now let's get back to message. When we can look at the former desolations. Now, since we're up to speed, I'm going to go through what God has given us for today. One of the things he wants to do concerning the former desolations is he wants us to understand that we don't have to fear anything. Somebody say, fear not.
Fear not.
So again, we are not to fear. You find me over and over again, I talk about that word fear, because it is something that the enemy tries to do over and over again. When it comes to confusion, he'll throw things, so many things your way to try to knock you off, to make you fear, make you be afraid, that you feel like you get frozen. And when you get frozen, what happens? You can't move. Okay. Amen. So he throws that fear your way to make you feel like, okay, what am I going to do? Or, Lord, what can I do? Or, Lord, I don't know what to do. But God is saying in his word, he has not given us a spirit of fear, but of what? Of power and of love and of a sound mind. Somebody say power. Somebody say love. And then somebody say a sound mind.
A sound mind.
So God has given those three things that we have to do, that when he begins to raise us up, we have to understand that we cannot be afraid of whatever the enemy throws our way. We got to go forward, and we got to go forward with boldness. Amen. Now, the second thing I want to throw out here again is the old things put away. Somebody say, old things put away.
Old things
so
put away.
So we talk about in terms of setting up the foundation. The foundation that the old ways, no more with the old ways, they shall, look at verse 4, and they shall build the what? Old ways. other things that were not good, or things in your life not good, or your life being whether it's in the past, things of the past will be built back up. Lost time. Somebody say lost time. Somebody say lost time. Whatever that was lost in time, God's going to restore that. He's going to restore what the cankerworm and the pommel worm has stolen from you.
Yes.
The old things. Somebody go to, let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And I know that you all are familiar with that passage of scripture.
Amen.
2 Corinthians chapter 5. So one of the things that he talks about, amen, 2 Corinthians chapter 5, is what? The old things. That old man. Sometimes, we don't want to let go of that old man. But you are a new creature, amen. God has made you a new creature. Verse 17, chapter 5, it says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a what?
New.
He is a new creature. Old things are done what?
Passed
away. Behold, all things are become what? New. So if you are a new creature and you are a new creature, those old things have got to pass away. That means the way you used to do things have got to pass away. Amen. You can't do it like you used to. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become what?
No.
All things. Some things become new. Right?
Mm-hmm.
Some things become new, right? 50%?
Nope.
Other things become new. Okay. 98% things become new. How many things become new?
All
things become new. So if all things become new, then we have to begin to ask ourselves, how are these things in our lives going to become new? They only can become new through the Word of God.
Amen.
We've got to read the Word of God. We've got to digest the Word of God. We have to meditate on the Word of God day and night that we may have what? Good success. Somebody say good success.
Good success.
That's the only way we're going to be what God has called us to be. Now you say, well, once I've received Jesus Christ as my personal Savior and been baptized, am I new? Yes, you are. But how many of you know that there are many things in your mind, the way you used to think, the way you used to do things, the way your perception of things is old. So when you begin to get in the Word of God, and when you pray that the Holy Spirit would begin to deal with you and show you, okay, listen, I know the way you used to do things and talk about things and carry out plans, that's the old way. But now I'm giving you a new and living way. Somebody said new and living way.
New and living way.
So we talk about the old man, the old things, they are passed away. Behold, all things are become what?
New.
New. And all things are God, who hath reconciled us to himself by Jesus Christ, and hath given to us the ministry of what? Reconciliation. To what that God was in Christ, reconciling the world unto himself, not imputing their trespasses unto them, and hath committed unto us the word of reconciliation. Now then, we are what? Verse 20. We are what? Ambassadors for Christ. That means we are spokesmen. Spokesmen and women of God, right? So that means we have become spokesmen and women of God. It says, as though God did beseech you by us, we pray you in Christ's stead. Be ye reconciled to God. For he hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Now let's go on to the next one. Now we talked about confusion a little earlier. I want you to go to Isaiah 61, same book. In verse 7, confusion, they shall rejoice. In their confusion, they shall rejoice. Somebody said rejoice.
Rejoice.
What do you mean? I'm supposed to laugh in my confusion? I'm supposed to be in a good spirit in my confusion? I don't understand this. I just don't understand. How can a person laugh when all hell has broken out? How can you possibly laugh and rejoice and say, yay, I lost my job. Yay, my marriage is going through some problems. Or yay, my children are acting up. Hallelujah.
Sometimes you got to. Sometimes you got to.
Yeah, that's right. That's what the word says. Amen. Yay, oh, hallelujah. My body's aching and pain. What? That just doesn't make sense. But see, when we talked about the old man, the new man, see, when you become on a new man on this side, your thinking is totally different. And so you on your job, and they just gave you eviction notice. I'm not eviction notice. They just gave you a piece of and said, you're fired. You say, thank you, Jesus. Everybody, huh? You should be crying. You should be worried about it. You should be like, oh, Lord, what am I going to do now? No. But what do? You rejoice. Amen. Because you know this thing is going to work together what? Together for who's good? For your good. You mean, how's it going to, me losing my job, how's it going to work together for my good? How's my kids acting up going to work together? How's my body aching and pain going to work? Listen, we talked about glory. It's going to bring glory to God. Because it's going to let people know that your life doesn't depend on these things, the circumstances. You don't live your life in joy, amen. When it comes to just your circumstances, when it comes to things, the circumstances, what's on the outside, right? So you begin to rejoice. See, look at here. Confusion, they shall rejoice. So verse 7, it says, for your shame, ye shall have what? You shall have what? Verse 7, Isaiah 61.
A double portion.
You shall have double, right? For your shame, ye shall have double. And for confusion, they shall do what? Rejoice in their portion. So if he says, for confusion, there it is. It's not me saying it's for confusion. They shall rejoice in their what? Their portion. So in your portion, whatever you're going through, he wants you to begin to rejoice. In your portion, look at here, it says, therefore in their land, they shall do what?
What rejoice. Shall they do?
What shall they do?
Rejoice.
No, what does it say? Therefore in their land, they shall. Y'all with me, verse 7. Thank you, okay. Possess. The double, possess the land, possess the double. Other words, listen, you think you got some joy now. Wait till you go through some trials and tests. When you come out of it, or even when you're going through it, you should have even more joy. Because you understand that, listen, this thing is coming my way because God's got something greater for me. Okay, but because God is giving it, bless me even the more. You see, when you're going through, if you haven't thought about this before, begin to think about it this way. Anytime you're going through, know that God is going to give you more than what the enemy has taken away. Amen? Again, if the enemy has say, let me make it plain, you've lost some finances. Okay, the enemy, or you got a bill or whatever, and the enemy has come and snatched away your income or whatever it may be, and you're like, okay, what's going to happen now? The mindset you have to get to is, listen, the enemy has taken from me what belongs to me. Now guess what I'm going to do? I'm going to get double for my trouble. I'm going to get back double what he took from me. Let's look at Job. Think about Job. Who knows the story of Job? Job lost everything.
His
everything.
Wife.
But yet still, what did God do? Amen. After he went through that trial and test, he had a testimony out of this world. He had a testimony to let people, God restored his family. You know, the enemy took his children, but what did God do? God restored to him, gave him even more. Amen. He had cattle, Job was in that time was what you'd probably be a billionaire. Amen. During that time. But the enemy took everything. He took his cattle, and the cattle, that was business. So he took his business, he took all of that, his possessions from him. Then he afflicted his body with pain. Amen. How could you rejoice when your body is afflicted with pain? Your children, your wife is gone, and your children is gone, your possessions is gone. How can you possibly rejoice in the Lord? But we saw that through it all, after it was all said and done, what happened? Job, he didn't have double. God gave him back a hundredfold. Amen. What he had before. And so it's the same thing that we can rejoice in knowing that God is going to give us double for our trouble. But what is it that we must do in the midst of confusion? What must we do?
Pray.
Rejoice.
Thank you. We must rejoice. Rejoice in the Lord of whatever we're going through, because God is going to give us back, amen, what we lost. Here's what I do know also. Let's go back to the scripture here, because there's something I want to bring out. Thank you, Lord. Romans, Elder Donna was touching upon this Thursday night. If y'all went on a Bible study Thursday night, y'all missed it. It was an excellent word. Excellent, I'm not just saying that, but it was a blessing. Amen. What God shared and how God used Elder Donna. And one of the things he brought out in Romans chapter 12, verse 1, it says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. Here's what I want y'all to understand. You present your bodies by the mercies of God. It's not because of how good you are or what you can do, but it's because of his mercy, because of his grace, why you're able to do what you're able to do, that you present your bodies in what? A living sacrifice. Listen, and what else? Holy. So you present your bodies a living sacrifice because of the mercy of God. You present your bodies holy because of the mercy of God. Mercies of God. And acceptable unto God, which is what? Your reasonable service. Now here's verse 2. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Your character shall be transformed. Y'all hear that? Your character. This is the first time I've seen this. Not just your mind being transformed. Because all the time we won't just focus on, okay, my mind being transformed, my thinking. But what about your character? Your character being transformed. Your character being transformed simply means that your actions that you take now will line up with God. That's why the enemy is always trying to discredit your character. He'll try to dig something up. He'll try to make something up. Amen. Your character. Why? Because he knows if he can try to discredit your character, then you ain't got nothing. That's why your character is so important. If you say something, if you say you won't do something, do it. Amen?
Amen.
Your character is so important. Amen. It's so important for us to begin to move in the things that God has set for us to move in. Amen. Look, be transformed by the what? Renewing of your mind. On the way he wants to be a new creature is for our minds to be what? Renewed. After we receive Christ as our personal Savior, that he may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. For I say through the what? Through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, look, listen to this next one, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to. Have you ever seen somebody who may think that they were more than what they are? But to think soberly, in other words, soberly means humble, with humility. Yeah, you know, God, even if you're confident in doing something and you're very skillful in doing something, you still say, hey, and people say, man, you're really good at that. And you say, well, it's just because of the grace of God. It's because of God. He's allowed me to do that. But when you fall in trouble, it's like, oh, yeah, I know I am. Thank you very much. I did this all by myself. It's all because of my genes, you know? No, it's because of God and what He has done. How God has helped you to be who you are and what you are. Amen. According as God, listen here, not to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of what? The measure of what? Faith. Thank you, Lord. Now let's go into Isaiah 58. I want you all to see this. So we were in Isaiah 61, and I saw this morning. Unto what God wants to help us. So the fourth thing is He wants to do the undo heavy burdens. Somebody say undo heavy burdens.
Undo heavy burdens.
Have y'all been any heavy burdens? If you had any heavy burdens, raise your hand. Heavy burdens. How do we undo the heavy burdens? How do we undo heavy burdens with ourselves and with others? Listen here. Look at verse 58. Cry loud, spare not, lift up thy voice like a trumpet, and show my people their transgressions and the house of Jacob their sins. Yet they seek me daily and delight to know my ways, as a nation that did righteousness, and forsook not the ordinance of their God. They ask of me the ordinance of justice. They take delight in approaching to God. Where have we fasted, say they, and thou sayest not? Therefore have we afflicted our soul. Now, what I want y'all to understand, this is very important because this is strategic on what's coming up for KOHA. What's so important is that this is talking about fasting and prayer. Is it on yet?
It's about to.
About to. This is talking about fasting and praying. Now, here is what I want you all to understand real quickly. Thou seest, it says, wherefore have we fasted, say they, and they, that thou seest not, wherefore have we afflicted our soul, and that takest no knowledge. Behold, in the day of your fast, we find pleasure in exact all your labors. Behold, ye fast for strife and debate, and to smite with the fist of wickedness. Ye shall not fast as you do this day. Do me a favor, Jamie. Get that plug for me and give it to, I don't know if there's a plug back there. In the back wall. You give it to Andrew. No.
Okay. Come on. Yeah,
okay. Either one. Maybe this one right here. That'll work. Okay. Sorry, y'all. So we look at, we talk about, behold, you fast for strife and debate and smite with the fist of the wicked. Ye shall not fast as you do in this day to make your voice to be heard. You know, people fast sometimes. They fast so they can be heard, so they can tell somebody out. You know, they fast so they can spirit man. And, you know, they say, well, you know, I'm going to prove that I'm right. But that's the wrong intention of fasting. Here's the verse 5 says, is it such a fast that I have chosen, a day for a man to afflict his soul? Is it to bow down his head as the bulrush, and to spread sackcloth and ashes under him? And back there in the days when they used to fast, they used to have ashes, and they put ashes all over their face, and you'll see their face will be pale. And it's just to show people that I'm humble, that I'm really fasting. But the truth is, when you fast and pray, nobody should know it. That was the difference between fasting in the old days and fasting in the Old Testament, and then we have the New Testament. In the New Testament, when you fast, no one should know.